Hello and welcome to our first episode of JLife Longevity TV. The nine hallmarks of aging. Why do we age? Because the years go by? It's true, but it's an indirect cause. In fact, we age because our cells age, and in particular, our DNA. To understand cellular aging, give me 2 minutes to explain how a human cell works. We have about 60 trillion smart cells. I have said smart because they understand our language and they communicate between them permanently. With rare exception, all cells have the same format. They are made up of a cell membrane packed with receptors that control all the entry points. This membrane serves as an envelope for two structures, the nucleus and the cytoplasm. The cytoplasm contains all the organelles responsible for the manufacture of protein, the production of energy thanks to the mitochondria, and the cleaning machinery called autophagy. The nucleus contains our 46 chromosomes which come equally from the father and from the mother. And these chromosomes contain between 20 and 30,000 genes that contains secret codes for manufacturing our 250,000 protein, which will in turn form the 200 cell families and the enzyme necessary for the proper functioning of those cells. All this machinery is of an inimaginable complexity, and yet it perfectly works every day. Every day until one or more weak links make the machine seize up. There are the weak links that are responsible for aging and most chronic diseases, and that we will see now. 20 years ago, when I started to be interested in human longevity, scientists considered that there were four main causes of aging. The repetitive damage suffered by our DNA, that they call progressive senescence. Then the loss of cells due to the shortening of telomeres, that they call replicative senescence. Then the lack of energy due to the scarcity of mitochondria. Those three causes combining leading to the scarcity of the number of stem cells and therefore a very large increase in senescent cells, which imbalance our homeostasy, that is to say our ability to adapt. In 2013, a scientific article written by five Spanish researchers and published in the famous scientific journal Cells revolutionized the small world of scientists. The title, The Hallmarks of Aging, an article of 120 pages that describe evidence to support the nine characteristics of human aging, and which made the tour of the world of university in few days. Professor Carlo Lopez Otin is the initiator of this study. He is a professor of biochemistry and molecular biology at the University of Oviedo in Spain. Professor Maria Blasco is a Spanish molecular biologist specialized in telomeres and telomerase. Since June 2011, she is the director of the National Cancer Research Center in Madrid. Professor Dame Linda Partridge is a British geneticist who studied the biology and genetics of aging and age-related diseases such as Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. Dr. Manuel Serrano is a professor of cells biology at the University of Barcelona, specializes in cell plasticity. Professor Guido Cromer is an immunologist and cell biologist who has contributed to the understanding of the role of mitochondria in cell death. I had to name each of the authors because they are the source of a medical revolution in the field of longevity. What do these researchers tell us? First of all, they confirm a well-established fact. Aging is a progressive loss of our physiological integrity, which leads to a deterioration of key function and thus an increased vulnerability to disease and death. This deterioration is the major risk factor for major chronic diseases, including cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular disorders, and neurodegenerative diseases. They identify 9 common factors that contribute to cellular aging, which are genomic instability, telomere shortening, epigenetic alteration, loss of protein quality, deregulation of nutrient sensing, mitochondrial dysfunction, cellular senescence, stem cell depletion, and impaired intercellular communication. The major challenge was not to identify them, but to discover their interconnection and especially to demonstrate a certain hierarchy in their relative contribution to aging. The ultimate goal was to identify pharmaceutical targets that will improve human health during aging with minimal side effects. But the originality of this study lies in the hierarchy of cause and consequences. The authors noticed that there were 4 major causes of aging, which are genomic instability, telomere shortening, epigenetic alteration, and loss of protein quality. Those 4 factors lead to the following consequences: deregulation of nutrient detection, mitochondrial dysfunction, and especially cellular senescence. And then, in the long run, there is a period of adaptation with, as consequences, the exhaustion of stem cells and the alteration of the intercellular communication. We can now better understand the why and the how of certain signs of aging. But let's start with the first one, genomic instability. That is to say, the consequences of the damage that our DNA undergoes permanently. This is a major factor and the one that has the most deleterious influence on all of the others. In fact, there is 2 DNA, the one of the nucleus and the one of the mitochondria. The one of the nuclei contains 25,000 genes, and the one of the mitochondria only 37, but with a major particularity. The mitochondrial DNA only comes from the mother. It is much more sensitive to oxidation than that of the nucleus. The damages against DNA are multiplied and daily. They can go from 10,000 a day to 1 million per day. At this rate, we should die in a few hours. And if it's not the case, it is because we have an ultra-effective repair system which will in a few seconds physically solve the break that it is on the vertical and horizontal bars of the DNA. So everything is fine until the moment when around 35, 40 years old, our repair system become less efficient in the sense that it takes a little longer to arrive and to solve the problem. The problem is that the DNA cannot afford any delay because the cells is constantly multiplying. So it will divide with a DNA that it's not repaired. So with missing or damaged genes. This is very annoying because we may need these missing genes to make certain proteins that are essential to our good health. And it is a daily repetition of this problem that will lead to chronic disease and premature aging. Where do these constant attacks come from? First of all, they come from the outside environment, toxic fumes, and of course, source of cigarettes, all type of pollution, UV rays, electromagnetic pollution, infection, but also stress or sedentary lifestyle or poor nutrition. These attacks also come within, and they are even more deleterious. It is a case of all the phenomena of oxidation, of the silent inflammatory state of glycation, that is to say the excess of sugar which freeze our protein. The absence of methylation, which is a chemical reaction essential for the activation or repression of genes. What can be done to reduce or eliminate those damages? It is impossible to eliminate it, but we can boost the repair system or reduce oxidation by increasing antioxidation, activate certain metabolic pathway, activate autophagy, or give what we call senolytics. But the best way is still a healthy lifestyle. The second scourge is the shortening of telomeres. You have probably heard of telomeres. They are part of the DNA, but are at the end of the strand and have no coding function. They have a sequence of nucleotide of the type of TTAGGG repeated 50 or 70 times. Their role is mainly to prevent the chromosome and DNA from unraveling. They are also responsible for preventing two DNAs from sticking together at the end, which can be very unfortunate. Unfortunately, when a DNA divides during mitosis, which is a process of cell division, there is a loss of the end of the chromosome where the telomeres are. It is a defect of the machine. As when once make thousands of skirt, they are false, but this loss do not affect the normal world because the telomeres are not coding for the manufacture of protein. However, there is a limit, which is between 50 and 70 division. the time to exhaust all the length of the telomeres. At this stage, everything changes because the DNA is not longer protected. And our common center sends a suicide order. It is called apoptosis, or an order of early retirement, and it becomes a senescent cell. In the first case, the solution is simple. The cell implodes, and the cleaner do the job, no trace. In the second case, the retirement is not easy. The cell pours all its debris into the neighboring cells, including very inflammatory molecules, endangering the whole neighborhood. But fortunately, there are cells that escape this dilemma because they have a special enzyme called telomerase. And when the genes for this enzyme is activated, it goes to work replacing brick by brick each lost sequence that is rebuilt, each lost sequence of telomeres. This is especially true for genital cells, eggs and sperms, for stem cells, and unfortunately also for cancers. For the other cells, we have the enzyme, but for some reason, the gene is not activated, while it is for other animal species. Anyway, the shortening of telomeres will lead to a big loss of cells. Can we do something about it? Yes, we can. With a healthy lifestyle and a sustained physical activity, we can at least delay the shortening and sometimes see a lengthening, a relengthening of telomeres. Some researchers prefer to focus on cell therapy using stem cells to replace the missing cells. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy has also been found to promote telomere lengthening. But it is mainly the telomerase activator that's being studied. They are combined from certain plants such as astragalus that could activate the telomerase gene. The third scourge is epigenetic modification. Epigenetic does not mean genetic. In fact, epigenetic literally means above genetic, and I will explain you why. As you know, we have between 20 and 30,000 genes located in each DNA. But what you may not know is that out of these 25,000 genes on average, only 5 to 10% are working full time. The others are requested on demand. For example, if your body needs to make skin cells, it will only use 5% of the genetic capital to make them. Same thing for the muscle cells, with a major difference: they are not the same 5% that the skin cells. So the researcher found that our genetic capital, which seems to be the master of our destiny, was not at all the master. It was simply a gigantic data bank that we could consult and use according to our needs. The dogma of all genetic has just fallen. But the major problem has to be solved. How do we use this or that gene qualitatively without denaturing it? It is by studying the intimate biological mechanism of protein production that they found the answer. When our body needs a specific protein, it sends a message to our nuclear DNA, which, like a robo, scans the DNA strand until it finds exactly which gene contains the manufacturing code of this special protein, and that is where it's become interesting. The DNA will open just where it needs to do, like a zipper. thanks to a chemical element called a methyl group. A copy of this precise piece of nucleotide will be made, and the carrier, called messenger RNA, you know that, will leave the nucleus in the cytoplasm to make or to manufacture the protein. If the methyl group is not there, the zip does not open. In the first case, we say that the gene is expressed, and the second one, where there is no methyl group, that the gene has been repressed. Those methyl groups act as switches, which will be on the on or off position. It remains to find out who decides, who commands, who is the conductor, the maestro, who changes the data without touching at the partition. For the moment, what we have is only observational data. For instance, we know that vitamin C will activate many genes that we have even identified. We know that the epigenetic data of an individual can be transmitted to his descendant, but that they can also be reversed according to the lifestyle. We could even treat cancers without having to kill innocent cells, but just by modifying the epigenetic character of the cells. This being said, why do epigenetic alteration represent the third essential characteristic of cellular aging? Mostly because of the methyl groups, more commonly called methylation, which is no longer as effective than before. For chemistry fans, when cytosine are associated with a guanine, they can lose or gain a methyl group, a CH3, which leads to a modification of the architecture of the chromatin fiber and modify the access of certain proteins to the genes, preventing their activity. It is from the potential of methylation that researchers like Steve Horvath have created biological clocks that will be marker of aging. Horvath tested his biological clock in 2016 on blood samples from 13,000 people with known dates of death to demonstrate the effectiveness of his method. The more epigenetic age is out of sync with chronological age, the higher the risk of mortality. In assessing risk factor, he unsurprisingly found that a diet rich in fish, fruit, and vegetable tend to decrease epigenetic age, or that heavy smokers have a certain type of methyl group indicating a more advanced biological clock. Lack of sleep, stress, or alcohol will also have negative effect. According to Horvath, 40% of our longevity will be determined by genetic factors. The rest is depending on our lifestyle. See you in our next episode for the rest of the hallmarks of aging. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.